So, tonight we tackle the subject of salvation. In theology, they call this soteriology. It means the study of salvation. You know, how do you get saved? What does it mean to be saved? So, there are a lot of references in the Old Testament to salvation, but they tend to be quite different than the New Testament passages that talk about how Jesus saves. But let's look at a few just to get the idea. Now, some of these you can look up later if you'd like. Some great passages here. We don't have time to read them all, or we'll never get through the whole outline. But in Genesis 3:16 is the first notion. It's called proto-evangelism, the first time there's a gospel. And it is where, you know, after Adam and Eve had sinned, as God was cursing the serpent, he was warning, or Genesis 3:15, he says to the serpent, "I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your seed and her seed. He shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel." It's predicting that the serpent ultimately would be destroyed by a seed of the woman. Now, women aren't thought of as seed, but because Mary was declared as a virgin, that it would certainly make sense with this. But it's really the first picture that we see of the Messiah coming, born of a woman, born of a virgin, and bringing salvation to people. But turn over to Exodus 15. We'll look at that one. It's the Song of Moses. Not used to teaching with one hand. This is terrible. Exodus 15, and especially, it's the whole chapter, but look at the first couple verses. "Then Moses and the children of Israel sang this song to the Lord and spoke, saying, 'I will sing to the Lord, for he has triumphed gloriously. The horse and its rider he has thrown into the sea. The Lord is my strength and my song, and he has become my salvation. He is my God, and I will praise him, my father's God, and I will exalt him.'" So he's declaring God to be his salvation. Over in 2 Samuel 22, we can look that one up. This last one Moses did, but this is David in 2 Samuel 22, as he is praising God. And 2 Samuel 22, the first four verses. It says, "Then David spoke to the Lord the words of this song. On the day when the Lord had delivered him from the hand of all his enemies and from the hand of Saul. And he said, 'The Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer.'" The word salvation, by the way, means to deliver. "The God of my strength, in whom I will trust, my shield and the horn of my salvation, my stronghold and my refuge, my Savior, you save me from violence. I will call upon the Lord, who is worthy to be praised. So shall I be saved from my enemies." So again, this picture of God being his salvation, the one who will rescue him, the one who will deliver him. You can read the rest of those. They're all good. In Psalm 51, you remember after David had sinned and committed murder and adultery, and as he repented, he said, "Restore to me the joy of salvation." And so, again, it's a salvation is associated with joy. Psalm 85 is a long one, but I said it's really good. It's a great passage. Now, the first time in the Old Testament where you really see the idea of someone dying in order to save someone else is that great passage in Isaiah 53, as Isaiah says, "Who has believed our report, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed?" In other words, who would believe this? "He would grow up before him as a tender plant, a root out of the dry ground. Nothing about him that looked so great. He was despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, and we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised and we esteemed him not. But he says, surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. The one who would come and suffer has borne our griefs. And he goes on and says, you know, that all we like sheep have gone astray. We've all messed up and done our own thing. But the Lord laid on him the iniquity of us all. I mean, that sounds like a New Testament passage. I've read this to Jewish people before and said, you know, where do you think that comes from in the Bible? And invariably they say, I don't know, somewhere in the New Testament for sure, maybe the Gospels, and it's from the prophet Isaiah. The big point, and you can look up the others, they're all awesome verses, but the big point I want to make here is that in the Old Testament, salvation was seen as this, what sometimes we would call providence, that God is working in our lives, that when we get in a tight spot, it's God who gets involved and helps us to be delivered. And so salvation isn't so much, in the Old Testament in general, salvation isn't about having your sins forgiven. It's not about, well, when you die, you can go to heaven. They really, most of the Old Testament didn't have a real concept of that. Now, we, in our day, have kind of sometimes missed some of the point of salvation because we think that all it is you make a deal, you get your ticket to heaven, and when you die, that's when salvation really pays off. Now, as we'll see, there's an element to that, but to understand salvation, we should understand that the Bible is talking about salvation in the big picture. It just turns out that it also has ramifications to our eternity and not just to our present life. It's something that we experience now as God is our protection and he is our rescuer, but at the same time, it's something that extends on beyond that. I think it's important for us to have both aspects. But we begin to see in the New Testament a whole different picture of salvation as Jesus is involved in it. And look over there at Matthew 1:21. This is where the angel came to Joseph, who was going to be the husband of Mary. And in Matthew chapter 1 and verse 21, the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, don't be afraid to take Mary as your wife, because she was pregnant, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Spirit. And she will bring forth a son, and you shall call his name Jesus. The name Jesus means Yahweh is salvation. And so, for he will save his people from their sins. Now that's a whole different revelation at this point, that Jesus is the one who brings salvation, not just to help you get out of a bind, not just to lead and guide you and make your life to be more lucky, but he actually can deliver you from your sins. It's the fact that, you know, and the Bible is unambiguous about this, the biggest problem that we have in our lives is our sin. Not because we're breaking rules or because we upset God, but sins are those things we do that rip us off, that rip other people off, that hurt us. That a sin is something that causes us to miss out on the best that God has for us. So sin is basically settling for something less than. And so here we see Jesus is going to come and rescue people from that. Now turn over to Luke chapter 1. And when Mary was pregnant, she went to, let John the Baptist's mom know about it. And then her husband, who was a priest, had this thing happen. You can read the story yourself, but he ends up, he couldn't talk, but then he was filled with the Spirit and he prophesied down in verse 77 as he's saying, well, verse 76, and you, child, will be called the prophet of the highest, for you will go before the face of the Lord to prepare his ways. He's talking about John the Baptist. To give knowledge of salvation to his people by the remission of their sins through the tender mercy of our God, with which the day spring from on high has visited us, to give light to those who sit in darkness and the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the way of peace. So he is prophesying about his son, John the Baptist, and he's saying, you are going to be able to announce to us this salvation, the knowledge of salvation by the remission of their sins. See, in the Old Testament, when they would talk about salvation, it was just about usually escaping your enemies. But now here is this clear revelation that salvation is more than anything else. It's having your sin dealt with. It's being able to figure out how best to live life and to actually get life instead of death. And then just right after that in Luke 2, we'll look at that too, when Jesus was brought to the temple to be dedicated. And this old man, Simeon, the Lord had revealed it to him. And down in we can start with verse 25. Behold, there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon. And this man was just and devout, waiting for the consolation of Israel. That was a name for the Messiah. And the Holy Spirit was upon him. And it had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord's Christ. In other words, somehow God had let him know, you are going to live long enough to see the Messiah show up. So, verse 27, he came by the Spirit into the temple. And when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him according to the custom of the law, he took him up in his arms and blessed God and said, Lord, now you are letting your servant depart in peace. I'm ready to die according to your word. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared before the face of all the people, a light to bring revelation to the Gentiles and the glory of your people Israel. So Simeon is declaring that this little baby is salvation. This is the gift of salvation. And so he, again, a pretty shocking revelation to someone who just sees a baby coming in, which was a normal sort of thing for them. Now, over in John 3, and we looked at this a few weeks ago as we're going through the Gospel of John on Sundays, but you're familiar with John 3:16 and probably 17 as well. But again, this is Jesus describing who he is and why he came. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. See, Jesus is revealing here in a conversation with Nicodemus that the reason why Jesus came is because God loves the world and wants to save the world. And that, and again, now it personalizes it and says, if you believe in him, then you will have everlasting life. Then you'll discover the life that you could have, a life that not only is rich here and now, but goes on forever. And so then some of these other verses I have here, we don't need to turn to all of them. In John 10:9, Jesus said, he talked about, I'm the door of the sheep. And he said that if you enter by me, you'll be saved. So I'm the door. I'm the path into salvation. Turn over to Acts chapter 2. And this is Peter giving his sermon on the day of Pentecost, the first day when the Holy Spirit came on the followers of Jesus. And he stands up to preach this sermon, but look down at verse 21. He's actually quoting Joel chapter 2, which was a prophecy. But he says, and it shall come to pass that whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. So he says, calling on the name of the Lord, really asking the Lord, using his name, and saying, I need you. I'm asking you to save me. That's actually what brings salvation. And then later on in Acts chapter 4, when he's preaching to the Sanhedrin, Acts chapter 4 and verse 12, he says, nor is there salvation in any other, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. In other words, Jesus exclusively is the source of salvation. He is the only way. It's not, well, all paths kind of lead to God ultimately. According to Peter, he says, no, there's no other path. There's no other way. There's no other name under heaven that people even know about by which you can be saved. So everyone who's saved is saved by the name of Jesus, in other words. Now turn over to Acts chapter 16. We have where Paul and Silas were in jail in Philippi. And, you know, there was an earthquake and everything was broken in the jail. But they ended up all staying there. And the jailer, when he realized that he had been spared, because if the prisoners had gotten away, he would be killed. But they were all still there. And so look at Acts 16 and verse 30. After this guy ran in and saw that the jailers were there, he fell down trembling before Paul and Silas in verse 29. And he brought them out and said, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" So they said, "Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and you will be saved, you and your household." So here, strong declaration from Paul. If you want salvation, you do it simply by Jesus. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and you'll be saved. So that's pretty simple for sure. Now, you don't have to turn there, but Romans 1:16, Paul refers to the gospel, the good news, as the power of God to salvation. But Romans chapter 10, you can turn over there, we have him explaining basically the methodology of how people get saved. How does it happen that you can be rescued by God, have your sins forgiven, and be able to know that you're going to be with him forever? He says, verse 8, what does it say? The word is near you in your mouth and in your heart, the word of faith which we preach, that if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus, that is, you say that Jesus is your Lord, that you want to follow him, and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead. So you trust Jesus and you believe in the resurrection, believe that God has raised him from the dead, you'll be saved. For with the heart one believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. So there's a pretty good formula there that lets us know that what you need to do is you believe in Jesus, you believe that he rose from the dead, you believe that he is the Lord, and you'll be saved. So you don't see super complicated kind of ideas about, well, you need to believe all these things. It's pretty simple. Salvation comes to people who believe in Jesus and who trust in him. Ephesians 2, 8, and 9, I have it written down there, where it just simply says, by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it's the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. Paul makes it clear. Salvation doesn't come because you're a good person. You don't get saved by being good. Because if you could be saved by being good, you would brag about it, and then you'd be bad. So it's simply grace. It's just by trusting in him, by faith, you know, you're saved for free. There's nothing that you can do to earn salvation. There's nothing you can do that can make you so bad that you won't be saved. But it's simply a gift from God. That's what salvation is. Now, I put Philippians 2:12 there. We don't have time to go into it, but that's where Paul says, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling, for it's God who works in you to will and to do of his good pleasure. It's a powerful passage, but at least what it shows us is that salvation is a process. It's not a single event. That there's a single event where you trust in Jesus, but there's a process in which he is working with you, he's working through you, and you are doing things not to save yourself, because again, Ephesians 2, 8, and 9 makes it clear that that's not the case, but it lets us know that life is a battlefield that, you know, to quote the great prophet, what's her name? But at the same time, I'm just going crazy, her husband's Neil Girardi. Pat Benatar, okay, good. Not that that matters, you don't need to write it down. But But the idea is salvation is something that we receive, but salvation is also something that's the rest of our lives as we work through issues and make sense of them. Now, you can turn over to 1 Peter chapter 1, because still, most of these passages are talking about having your sins forgiven and having your life changed. But here in this passage in 1 Peter chapter 1, it kind of ties it in more with your inheritances and going to heaven and those kinds of things. Beginning with verse 3, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his abundant mercy has begotten us again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. So far, that sounds a lot like what we've already seen. But he says, to an inheritance that's incorruptible and undefiled and that does not fade away, reserved in heaven for you, who are kept by the power of God through faith for salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. And as you read on down there, it's the end of your faith is the salvation of your souls. So here Peter is saying, salvation is certainly about being forgiven. It's certainly about having your life turned around here. It's certainly about having a fresh start. But it's also about this guarantee that God has given us that we have an inheritance and can spend an eternity in heaven with the Lord. And so I think it's good to remember that salvation happens now. Salvation affects our lives in the present. But there is the aspect also of it being future, of there being promises. Don't trade one for the other. Salvation is not just about going to heaven, but salvation is also not just about life here. It's about both, and really wouldn't be worth much if it didn't do both. Now, I have 1 Timothy 2:4 there. You don't need to turn there. I just think it's an interesting verse because it says that God desires for all men to be saved. This kind of takes away the notion that God only saves certain people that he chose. There are people who teach that there are only certain people who actually God wants to save them. But Paul makes it very clear. God wants everyone to be saved. So if you're saved or if you aren't saved, I want you to understand, he wants to save you. And he wants to save the people that you know who you may think are way far off. His heart is, as Peter tells us too, God isn't willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. God wants to draw people to himself. That's his desire. But he will not violate your will. He will not force you to be saved if you don't really want to. Now, the next section that I put, Christ died for us as a substitution, Isaiah 53:6, I already quoted that, where it said, he bore our griefs and carried our sorrows. All we like sheep have gone astray. We've turned everyone to his own way. And the Lord laid on him the iniquity of us all. The idea that our failure gets put on him, and he paid the price for it. He died for it. So there's no reason really for us to have to pay for our sins because he paid for them already. What a glorious truth that is. 1 John 4:10, I have it in there. And it's interesting. You don't need to turn there. But it does say that he is the propitiation for our sins. And then he says, and not for ours only, but the sins of the whole world. In other words, Jesus didn't just die just to forgive the sins of the people who accept him, that he actually died for the world. John 3:16, we saw that, for God so loved the world. So this kind of eliminates the notion of limited atonement, that Jesus only died for some. He was sufficient to save all. Now, if you reject him, then his death doesn't save you. But the fact is, he died with the intention of making it possible for everyone to save him. And any idea of God that doesn't include this broad offer, this heart that desires for everyone to be saved, may be comfortable from a theological standpoint, but that's not God, according to what the Bible teaches. But 1 Peter 2:24, you can turn over there if you'd like. Where Peter says this, He was talking about Jesus. He didn't sin in verse 22. He suffered for us in verse 21, which is substitution. But then in verse 24, he gets down to it. Who himself bore our sins in his own body on the tree, that we, having died to sins, might live for righteousness, by whose stripes you are healed. Quoting Isaiah 53 there. For you were like sheep going astray, again a reference to Isaiah 53, but have now returned to the shepherd and overseer of your souls. So Christ died for us and takes our sins upon himself. In 1 Corinthians 15, where we see that Paul describes what the gospel is, and he makes it clear, Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, and he was buried and he rose again the third day according to the scriptures. A part of the most basic New Testament statement of salvation, it says that he died for our sins. We don't have to fix our own sins. He died to pay the penalty for our sins. And then turn over to 2 Corinthians 5:21. This is really an important passage because it's such a beautiful depiction of what happens when we are saved, what happens when we do receive Jesus Christ. And it's the great exchange. It's this amazing truth, 2 Corinthians 5, verse 21, where he says, "For he made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him." So God allowed Jesus on the cross to take all of the sin on himself. He had never sinned. He never did anything wrong. But everything stupid you've ever done and I've ever done and everyone else has ever done was put on him at that moment. And because of that, if we allow him to, if we receive him, then his righteousness gets put on us. And you might go, that doesn't seem fair, that substitution thing. But, I mean, he has the right to do it. It's not really fair, except it is in a way, because if that's what he wanted to do, if he wants to take our sins, I'm not going to argue with him. And if he wants to just give me righteousness for free, I'm good with that too. It's a great deal. It's absolutely foolish to reject this gift, to not receive him, but he offers this exchange. And again, like Paul said in Ephesians, this is just by grace. This is just a gift from him. So for all of us, we have to hear him looking at us and saying, would you like to be forgiven for free? I paid for your sin already. I died for your sins. I rose again. I love you. I want you to be saved. I want you to be rescued. So here, you can have my righteousness for free. It's not about you making yourself righteous. It's about you receiving his gift of righteousness to you. And he says, I'll take your sin. Amazing. So the question that I have here, first of all, is how much do you need to believe to be saved? It seems pretty simple. And the different scriptures that we've read give us a little more and a little less information. But there was a thief that was hanging on a cross next to Jesus. And all he said to Jesus, he looked at him and said, remember me when you come into your kingdom. This guy, no doubt, had no theological information at all. He didn't know the four spiritual laws or the Romans Road or any other formal thing. He probably didn't even know. I mean, he somehow had a sense that Jesus was going to rise from the dead because he said, I want you to remember me when you come into your kingdom. I don't know if he knew that Jesus was God. I'm quite certain that he didn't have a concept of the Trinity. But all he did was he cried out to Jesus. Again, you see, you know, it's whoever calls upon the name of the Lord will be saved. It's just calling out to him. And, of course, you know, then Paul in 1 Corinthians 15 talks about that you need to believe in the resurrection. But even that, probably that's a good story of good news, because how could you know that Jesus can save you if you don't know that he came back from the dead. If he died, it just makes him look like everyone else. So you want Jesus to save you. You are calling out to him. You desire to be saved by him. You believe that he died for your sin, that somehow what he did on the cross made it possible for you to be saved. And you believe that he came back from the dead. That's the most basic formula that I could come up with, that in all these verses that we've looked at and some of the ones that we didn't, I would have to say it's pretty simple. Now, the question becomes, guy, there are people who will say they believe this, but they believe all kinds of other crazy stuff. You know, at what point do you believe the right stuff to be saved, but then you continue to believe all sorts of other goofy stuff along with it? Well, and this is what happens in some of the other religions, other, you know, sometimes we call them cults or sects of Christianity, where they will say, like the Mormons, for instance, will say, yeah, I believe that Jesus is God. He died for our sins. He rose from the dead. And so you go, check, check, check. You know, sounds pretty good. But then they believe some other really wacky stuff, and you just have to go, and I'm just not sure that I'm qualified to say exactly how much stuff can you mix in with the gospel before now it's become corrupt. I will say that the Bible makes it clear that when we accept Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit comes to live in our lives. The Holy Spirit will lead us into all truth, Jesus said. So I think sometimes if somebody's a new believer, they might know almost nothing, but then at some point you either decide to accept what his word says and the Holy Spirit helps you to see that, or you decide to reject what his word says. But it's not for me to judge. It's just, to me, we should make an assumption that if somebody wants Jesus to save them, I'm not going to say, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you'll be saved, and you need to believe in the Westminster Catechism of Faith. You need to believe in our doctrinal statement. You need to believe just the way I do. I suspect when we get to heaven, we're going to be shocked at all the people who are there, and probably shocked by some of the people who aren't there. But ultimately, I don't think we should be judging people as to whether we think they're going to heaven or not. What we should do is just continue to show the love of Jesus, teach his word, declare his goodness and his grace. And sometimes, and again, salvation so often is sort of a process. It is something that you go through. And so just cracking the door open, I mean, when you first became a Christian, how much did you really know? For some of you, maybe you knew a lot. Like for me, I had been raised in the church. I had read the Bible since I was 2 years old. So when I got saved, I already knew a ton of theology. I already had so much of the Bible down, a lot of it memorized and everything. But for some people, it's like totally new to them. All I think is that we should be a broken record of you need to put your trust in Jesus. He died for you and he rose from the dead. And that's where salvation comes from. But I talked to people who, I had a dear friend. He was like a father to me, who's my karate instructor, Ed Parker. And he was a long time, he grew up in the Mormon church. And he rejected an awful lot of what the church was teaching. And I grilled him on the gospel. And everything that we believe, he would believe. But then he'd go off on UFOs and all kinds of kooky stuff. But, you know, I have people now that I know who've even gone to our church for years. And when I talk to them, I'm amazed at some of the crazy things they believe. But I suspect that when I get to heaven, I'm going to go, what an idiot I was. A lot of the stuff I believed, you know, turns out to be bogus, or I misunderstood, or somebody told me wrong. So to me, it's like we have to stay back on the basis of salvation, that it's Jesus himself, that he is the point of salvation, that he is the object of salvation. So then we have the question, how were Old Testament saved saints, Old Testament saints saved? In other words, in our sense, how did an Old Testament person end up going to heaven? Because they didn't have a concept of that. For most Old Testament people, they wanted God to rescue them from their enemies, And then they wanted God to fulfill his promises to their descendants. They were a collectivist society. So an individual Jew wouldn't have a concept of, I want to go to heaven forever. We are an individualistic society, so for us, that's the big thing. For them, it was, as long as you keep your promises to my offspring, then I'm thrilled to know that that will continue. But there is still heaven. So how could someone from the Old Testament end up having access to spend an eternity in heaven? And think of it like this. When we believe in Jesus, we are looking back at the cross. We are saying, he died for my sins, he rose from the dead, and I'm trusting that for my salvation. Well, for a person in the Old Testament who believed in God, who wanted to follow him, what they would do is they would do sacrifices. Sacrifices didn't forgive sins, though, and they knew it, that the blood of bulls and goats could never take away sin. It can't really change your life, but what they were doing was acknowledging their sin and sacrificing a valuable animal as a symbolic kind of way of recognizing that their sins hadn't been forgiven. But Old Testament people who did that and had that heart for God were saved by, like, on credit. In the same way that I look back at the cross, they were actually looking forward to the cross, even though they didn't understand all of that. And like I said, most of us, when we get saved, we don't understand all the details. We're just like, okay, I'm trusting in Jesus. For them, they were trusting in the idea that there would be a Messiah who would come and rescue them. For them, every sacrifice that they made was actually, without them completely understanding it, was a picture of the one who would one day die for their sins. And so a person in the Old Testament, I believe, who went through that sacrificial system and believed and had faith in Jehovah God, in Yahweh, those people were actually being saved by Jesus, even though they didn't know the name of Jesus. We in John's gospel, Jesus, we just saw last week where he says, Abraham, you know, was excited about seeing my day, and he saw it. And then he says, before Abraham was, I am. In other words, Jesus is claiming that he was around during the Old Testament. And he's saying, Abraham was glad to see me as his Savior, because Abraham would follow God, which maybe not knowing that it would become, that God would be end up being Jesus, but he was doing the best he could to do what God told him to do, even to the extent that he was willing to offer his son Isaac when God told him to. And the offering of Isaac up there on the same mountain where Jesus would one day be sacrificed himself was a picture of what was going to happen in Jesus, and that was what Abraham was actually believing. So Old Testament saints looking forward. Now, during the kingdom age, when God again is dealing with Israel, a lot of people are really puzzled by the fact that it seems like they have, well, they have a temple and they're actually making sacrifices. And we go, oh, that would be horrible to make sacrifice. Jesus was already the sacrifice. Well, I don't understand all of that, but I will say this, that if they are making sacrifices during the kingdom age, which is yet future, following the time of the tribulation, then they are doing that as a memorial to what Jesus did on the cross. They're still looking back on that in the same way that when we partake in communion, we are remembering what Jesus did on the cross. It's all about Jesus, though. Being saved has to do with connecting with him and receiving his forgiveness. Now we have, in the time we have left, to talk about eternal security. This is a big issue for people. You know, and the idea of eternal security is, once you are you saved for good? Or can you lose your salvation? And it's kind of an important thing. If I'm believing in Jesus and I believe that I'm saved, is there something that could happen? If I do something really bad, or if I slack off or get bitter about something or whatever, if I, you know, there are people who think that if you commit suicide, then you won't go to heaven, you will lose your salvation. So how secure are we? And we have, I gave you a list of some verses that we can look at briefly. 1 John 5:13 just says, these are written that you may know that you have eternal life. So eternal life, which starts now and goes on forever, is something that you can know that you have it. Now, if you can know that you have it, then it would seem like you can't lose it, because if you lose it, then it wasn't eternal. And you knew that you had it, and then you didn't have it. Of course, the great passage over in Romans 8, and you can look this up on your own later, but he says, nothing can separate us, Paul says, from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus. Neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing can keep us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus. Ephesians 1:4 talks about the fact that we were chosen before the foundation of the world. You can't be chosen and then end up being unchosen or being not chosen. At least that's the argument that people make. I'm not saying all of these are locked tight, because, for instance, just because it says nothing can separate us, you know, it doesn't mean that we can't separate ourselves if we so choose. I don't think God's going to force people to go to heaven if they decide they don't want to. And, you know, Jesus talked about the 12 disciples and said, I chose you 12, and yet one of you I lost, Judas. So it's not a Loctite thing, but it does seem to be an indication of this is security. Philippians 1:6 says, he that has begun a good work in you, if God has begun a good work in you, Paul says, he is faithful to complete it. That would make me feel like, hey, if he has started, if he's done something in my life, he's going to finish what he started. And then the passage that I listed there in John chapter 10, Jesus talks about, you know, that they were his sheep and follow him, they know him, and he gives them eternal life, and they'll never perish. And he says, and nobody can pluck them out of my Father's hand. My Father is greater than me, and no one is able to pluck you out of my Father's hand. And then he says, I and my Father are one. So all of those are verses that make me feel comforted and secure. Like, oh, good. Salvation is not just me hanging on to Jesus, but salvation is Jesus hanging on to me. So I like that emphasis for sure. And you know, there again, you can't get around those passages, but I want you to look at a couple of verses that people use and say, well, this sounds like insecurity. In John chapter 15, verses 4 through 6, and you can turn over there, really important passage that we'll be dealing with in, I don't know, 5 or 6 weeks. Jesus is talking to his disciples. In verse 4, he says, abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. You got to stay in me. I'm the vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me, and I in him, bears much fruit. For without me, you can do nothing. If anyone does not abide in me, he is cast out as a branch and is withered. And they gather them and throw them into the fire, and they are burned. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, you'll ask what you desire, and it shall be done for you. People who really want to hang on to eternal security will twist this to make it sound like, oh, no, that's talking about you're losing your rewards in heaven, or you won't have as good of a life. But to me, if he tells you to abide in him, and we also saw just last Sunday in John chapter 8 where he talked to the Jews who believed in him and said, if you abide in my word, then you're my disciples indeed. If you're telling somebody they need to stay, it sort of presupposes the possibility of not staying and not abiding. But John 15, when you're taken and burned and everything, that does not sound like, oh, you just missed your reward. That sounds absolutely like there's something that you can choose to do where you will turn your back on your relationship with God and fall away. And I can't really escape that. And then, again, in 1 Corinthians 15, it says that the gospel, after he describes the gospel, he says, it saves if we hold fast. If we hang in there, then the gospel saves us. If we don't, it won't. And then this verse in Revelation chapter 3 and verse 5, you can turn over that if you'd like. As Jesus is talking to the church in Sardis, which was a church there in Turkey, he's telling them there are certain things they need to repent of, and there are some people who are still good, though, and they aren't defiled. Look at verse 5. He who overcomes shall be clothed in white garments, and I will not blot out his name from the book of life, but I will confess his name before my Father and before his angels. Now, it doesn't say that your name can be blotted out of the book of life, but he's making a promise to those who overcome, and he says, I won't blot your name out of the book of life. It certainly sounds like it's possible if you fall apart and reject him, walk away from him, or whatever. It does entertain the possibility of having your name blotted out of the book of life. Now, I had somebody send me an email just today asking about this question, and people have come up with this whole suggestion that everybody who's alive is in a book of life. So the book of life is a list of people who are alive, and you get blotted out if you die and you haven't accepted Jesus, and everybody who's left is, you know, the ones who live forever. It's just, it fits, but it's something that's made up basically to try to explain why it talks about having your name blotted out of the book of life. And there's a place in the Old Testament that says this as well. I'm just not going to go, I don't like to interpret the Bible using excuses. I don't like to interpret the Bible going, okay, I need to make this consistent. For me, you know, I hang on to the verses about security, but I'm aware of the verses that would be insecure, and I'm not going to pick and choose, because at the end of the day, I want to be able to say, I believe everything that the Bible said. So I understand those people who believe that you can lose your salvation. I understand people who believe that you can't lose your salvation. I have no intention of losing my salvation, because I'm going to abide in Jesus, and that's how I know that. Now, some of the other concerns that I have down there regarding the, and again, we can agree to disagree. I'm sure that some of you believe that you can absolutely lose your salvation. There are Arminians who believe, you know, that you can lose your salvation one week and get it back the next week and lose it the next week and get it back the next week. There are other people who primarily either Calvinists or Baptists. Baptists are the ones that usually say, once saved, always saved, and they're usually the ones that talk about eternal security. And they're good people, and I have no problem with people believing that. There are scriptures that support it. There are just some scriptures that I'm not going to throw away in order to be consistent. Then there are Calvinists who mostly talk about the term the perseverance of the saints, and I'll talk about that in a moment. I'm going to have to be quick about this, though. But here's the traps of this whole question. The trap of eternal security is that if you believe that you pray a prayer and therefore you are saved and nothing else that you do is going to make a difference, and I know people who believe this. I remember talking with one guy who was a pastor at Calvary Costa Mesa when I was, and I said, so what if a guy comes forward, prays a prayer, really means it, and then he never changes at all? He's a hitman for the mafia. He's horrible, beats his wife, he kills people. He's just living this awful life. Are you telling me that he's going to go to heaven because he prayed that prayer? And he said, absolutely. Well, that's kind of an issue, you know, to me. It's like, it causes you to think, okay, I'm set, and I don't ever have to even consider the question again. Paul talks about how important it is for us to consider ourselves, for us to make sure that we are of the faith. The trap of no eternal security is that you can never be sure. You can go, okay, I'm saved right now, but how do I know what's going to happen next week? And so we don't have that sense of, I can trust God, which is, you've seen it, and you can look these verses up again throughout the Bible, and it's like, security is important, and you don't have security if you're just believing that you can get saved, lost, saved, lost, saved, lost, or worse yet, you can get saved, and then if you get lost, you can never come back to repentance. People get that from Hebrews chapter 6, and I don't have time to go into that. I'll do it on another time. There's also something called lordship salvation, which John MacArthur is the most popular proponent of it. And what MacArthur believes is that, you know, once you're saved, you're saved. But he says most people who think they're saved aren't. Because he would say, if you're not walking totally in obedience to the Lord, if Jesus isn't the Lord of your life, then he isn't the Savior. And I understand what he's saying, and it has some merit. But the problem with that is you're never going to be good enough to ever feel secure. The truth is that when you are a Christian, things change in your life. And so if nothing changes and you say you're a Christian, you got to wonder, okay? But at the same time, it's not a healthy thing to be constantly worried that you're not good enough. Then salvation becomes by merit, not by grace through faith. So those are dangers there. Now, I said the Reformed churches, Presbyterians and all Calvinists, would refer to this as perseverance of the saints, meaning that if you are really a Christian, if you really are regenerated and you have the Holy Spirit in you, that you'll last. But they would say, all you find out by the end, if you were really saved or not, whether or not you make it to the end. And so they would say, if somebody's walking with the Lord for a while and then they stop walking with him, I guess they were never saved because they didn't persevere. They didn't last. Now, the scripture that they usually use on this is 1 John chapter 2, where John says about certain people who had left, and he said, they went out from among us. This is hard to follow, but follow it. I'll say it slowly. They went out from among us because they weren't really of us. If they had been of us, they would have stayed with us. But they went out to show that they were never really in, that they were never really of us. In other words, you can't tell that somebody's a Christian just by the fact that they're into it for a while. Real Christians hang in there. The Holy Spirit seals you, and you're locked in. And that's pretty good. Ultimately, it's semantical, because whether you are an Arminian, whether you are a once saved, always saved Baptist, whether you are a Calvinist with the perseverance of the saints, if today I'm believing in Jesus, but someday I stop believing in him, then I can't say that I was saved and now I'm lost, because salvation is eternal life. So it's like if I announce that I have an unlimited lifetime supply of peanut butter, and you go, oh, can I have some? Well, I'm out. Well, you not that you lost your supply, it was that you never had an unlimited supply, or you would still have it. And so that's kind of the Reform notion of perseverance of the saints, and from a semantical standpoint, I think that has a lot of merit. But I have seen people who absolutely believe in Jesus, have trusted him, walk with him, share the gospel with people, go to the mission field and everything else, and then today they don't believe in God at all. They become atheists. I don't know how to describe those people. Can I say that they're still saved? Well, I do believe that there are people who are saved who go through really dark times, who just, they don't want to believe, they're tired, they're depressed, not in their right mind. And so certainly if you're backslidden, and the scriptures talks about people who are like that, that doesn't mean you're not saved. But if somebody's just absolutely, I do not believe in God and I do not want to go to heaven, I don't see God going, too bad, you got saved and now you have to go. That just doesn't make sense. So, but what do I call them back then? I have an older sister who was an on-fire Christian, went on missions trips, knew the Bible, she was an evangelist and all, but today she's basically an atheist who is a Buddhist, And she believes that she's a shaman. She's also a psychologist, which goes right along with it, but not really, I'm just kidding. But she is a psychologist. But she told me a couple of years ago, David, a guy came in for counseling, and he told me that he needed Jesus. He wanted to accept Jesus. So she said, I led him in the sinner's prayer, and his life's totally changed, and he's doing great. So she knows so much that she can lead somebody else to Jesus, and she saw no problem with that, but she herself is not following Jesus. So I can't say that what she was missing something. I can't judge, but I know plenty of people. I have a friend who's an atheist who was a missionary and a pastor, and I've asked him, before, back when you were younger, did you totally believe? He absolutely said, I was completely committed. So I just think we need to make sure not to blur our categories too much, and also to remember that it's important for us to hang in there. Now, final word. A lot of people, one of the worst things about this kind of deal is that people who wonder if they're really saved. And maybe through this talk, you're looking at your life and going, I don't know if I'm saved or not. I'm not even sure if this applies to me or if it doesn't. And sometimes people that believe, I think I've lost my salvation. A lot of times when I talk to people who are depressed, they believe that they've lost their salvation. I talked to a girl the other day who is feeling suicidal, and she goes, I know I'm going to hell. And yet, I know she believes in Jesus. I've known her for a long time, and I'm sure that she does, but you get so low, you just can't, you know, see straight when it comes to this. Here's the thing about, if you ever feel like, I'm afraid I'm not saved, Dr. McGee, J. Vernon McGee, used to say, he said when he was a new Christian, the devil came to him and goes, McGee, you're not really saved. How could a guy like you be saved? And he said what he did is he goes, devil, I think you might be right. So I'm going to get saved right now. And he would just pray and accept the Lord. Next day, McGee, you're not really saved. Maybe you're right. Lord, I accept you into my heart. Say he did it like 3 or 4 times, and then he never felt that again. But the other thing that I tell people all the time, and this is really important, if you're worried about whether you're saved or not, you're probably saved. Because it's only the Holy Spirit who even draws us to want to be saved. People who reject Jesus don't sit around worrying about whether or not they're saved. People either know that they're not saved and they're okay with that. People know that they're not saved and they want to get saved. Or then people who are saved are sitting there worrying about whether or not they are. Sometimes we just think that salvation is all about us being perfect. And it isn't. Never was, never will be. But if you are thinking, ooh, I wonder if I'm saved, well, you can go the McGee route. Just go ahead and accept the Lord tonight. Or you can just realize the only way that I can even care is if the Holy Spirit is inside of me, convicting me of that. So I think most people that are in a panic thinking that they're not saved probably are. Or they wouldn't even be concerned about it. So take some comfort in that. Sorry I went so far over tonight, but it's kind of an important topic. Maybe I'll try to let you out early next week. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for this amazing salvation that you've given us. Thank you for dying for our sins, rising from the dead, making it possible for us to be forgiven and to be actually righteous. Lord, help us to be able to share your love with others, because we know that there are people out there who you want to rescue, and they don't realize it yet. So God, I pray by your Spirit that you would draw people to you, that you would help us to just explain this really simply and clearly. We wouldn't get off on talking about a guy being swallowed by a whale or how old the earth is or anything, but that we would just talk about you, that you were perfect and you died for us and you came back from the dead like nobody else ever has, and that you are offering to forgive us for free. So Lord, if there's anybody here tonight who has never really accepted that gift of salvation, help them to know they don't need to understand everything. All they need to know is, I need some help here. Help them to know you love them, that you want to forgive them, that you want to change their life and make it so much better than they ever imagined it could be. And we just thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Somebody's phone's ringing like, okay, I'm really late.
Hey, God bless you guys. And we'll see you hopefully on Friday night if some of you come to the album release party. And otherwise, we'll see you on Sunday morning.